In one of his best-known poems, Rilke describes his encounter with a headless Greek sculpture. I'll read the poem in English translation, essentially by Edward Snow. We never knew his head and all the light that ripened in his fabled eyes, but his torso still glows like a candelabra in which his gazing, turned down low, holds fast and shines. Otherwise, the surge of the breast could not blind you, nor a smile run through the slight twist of the loins toward that center where procreation thrived. Otherwise, this stone would stand deformed and curt under the shoulder's invisible plunge, and would not glisten like a wild beast's fur, and not burst forth from all its contours like a star, for there is no place that does not see you. You must change your life. The poem is famous in part because it is a testament to the power of art. It's also an extraordinarily vivid description of the experience of meaning wherever we encounter it, and it puts a paradox at its heart. Although the statue is headless, what we see is its gaze, a gaze that remains present, tangible, in the eyeless marble of the torso. The radiance of this gaze informs the fragment, and it informs us too. It reaches right into us and demands a response. My proposal is this. Once the question of truth is settled, and often prior to it, what we value in a proof or conjecture is what we value in a work of lyric art. Potency of meaning. An absence of clutter is a feature of such artifacts. They possess a resonant clarity that allows their meaning to break on our inner eye like light. But this absence of clutter is not tantamount to being simple. Consider Eliot's four quartets or Mozart's late symphonies. Some truths are complex, and they are simplified at the cost of distortion, at the cost of ceasing to be truths. Nonetheless, it's often possible to express a complex truth in a way that precipitates a powerful experience of meaning. It is that experience we seek, not simplicity per se, but the flash of insight, the sense we've seen to the heart of things. I'm going to try to say a little bit about what is involved in such recognitions, and then I'll try to say something about why an absence of clutter matters to them. A sustained attempt to discuss the experience of meaning in scientific terms was undertaken by a group of philosopher psychologists in Germany in the first half of the 20th century. They called it Gestalt perception. By the mid-1930s, the three leading exponents of the Gestalt school, Max Wertheimer, Wolfgang Köhler, and Kurt Kafka, had immigrated to the US. Despite considerable contemporary interest in their views, Gestalt theory was eclipsed on this continent by behaviorism, and in Germany by schools whose agendas coincided with those of Nazi and post-war regimes. The central tenet of Gestalt theory is often represented as the claim that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. This representation is not entirely accurate. What Gestalt theorists maintained was that wholes are different than the sums of their parts, and we perceive wholes first. That's the key. Wholes, they argued, are both logically and epistemologically prior to their parts. Quote, parts do not become parts, do not function as parts, until there is a whole of which they are parts. A gestalt may be defined as a system of sorts, then, all of whose aspects are in dynamic interrelation with each other and with the whole. It is an integrated totality in which each part has a place or functions in a way that enables the whole to be stably what it is. A gestalt, in other words, is very much like an ecosystem. Some examples may help focus this conception. One of the most striking is melody. Many of us with no musical training can hum on demand any number of popular songs and Christmas carols. But if we're asked to specify the notes we're singing or the intervals between them, we have to shrug. Yet we can transpose the melody as a whole into a new key with little effort. We can recognize it, speed it up or slow down or in an unfamiliar arrangement. And even when it's hummed out of tune or with a few wrong notes. These facts are inexplicable on the view that melodies are aggregates of elements, each of which we perceive individually and then stick together with some sort of epistemic glue. Melodies are oral shapes. We perceive these shapes, not their constituents, spontaneously. Another good example is the face. Most of us instantly recognize hundreds of them, but if asked to draw them or to describe their individual features, we flounder. Our experience is not of perceiving an eye of particular shape and color, a nose of a particular length and width, another eye, a mouth, a couple of eyebrows, and scattering some virtual plus signs among them and concluding from the aggregate that the person we've glimpsed through the window in the passing cab is our downstairs neighbor. What on earth is she doing in New York? We exclaim in the split second it takes for the cab to draw away. Repeated laboratory experiments have shown that we are in fact better at recognizing faces if we have not used an identikit to reconstruct individual features first. What Wertheimer and his colleagues maintained is that all productive thinking, thinking that involves insight, thinking that precipitates an experience of meaning, involves the experience of gestalts. Such experience comes in two types. In some cases, we move from a chaotic situation, a jumble of lines, concepts, sounds, or data, to a situation in which we discern a pattern or structure. The face springs out at us. The identity of the culprit dawns. In the second type of gestalt experience, we move from one meaningful array to another with the same elements but a different structure. Some of the most famous discoveries in the history of science and mathematics are examples of such gestalt shifts. Poincaré's famous description of his recognition that the transformations he had used to define Fuchsian functions were identical with those of non-Euclidean geometry. Or Newton's equally famous autobiographical account of the origin of his conjecture about the nature of gravity. And here, yes, it worked. I'm famous for jinxing these sorts of things. And here's a standard visual proof of the Pythagorean theorem that depends on seeing the area of the square with side C as the combined areas of the squares with sides A and B. Insight, the experience of meaning, fundamentally involves the spontaneous perception of structure, not analytic order, one brick stacked on another, but resonant internal relations. Right? When you can see that the two big squares have to be the same size, right? Because they have sides of length AB. One square, you've taken out four triangles ABC. In the other square, you've taken out four triangles ABC. The conclusion is inescapable. We see this relationship. We might describe internal relations by saying that the aspects of a gestalt are interdefined. In a culture that identifies thinking with the aggregation of atoms or elements, the acknowledgement of such wholes is difficult. The dominant epistemology makes them literally unthinkable. Critics of Gestalt theory, like logical positivists, especially dislike the concept of internal relations. Virgil Aldrich provided a classic statement of the complaint, quote, "Couldn't Professor Wertheimer have written at least one chapter of Gestalt theory of learning without once using the semi-metaphorical term inner? Oh, doubtless there are inner meanings to be apprehended, but a theory of these should contain some literal analysis of the term to provide means to identify and manipulate them in an objective way." No metaphors, literal analysis, objectivity. This is not a critique of Gestalt theory, but a statement of the view that it must be wrong. One way of attempting to understand the Gestalt project is to say that Wertheimer put the concept of metaphor, More precisely, the concept of significant similarity and the notion of internal relations on which it depends, where standard theory puts the concept of epistemological atoms. The appeal to internal relations isn't an attempt to avoid the issue, it's an attempt to state what the real issue is. Wertheimer did not pretend all the problems with such a fundamental reformulation had been solved. Quote, "My terms should not give the impression that the problems are settled. They themselves are loaded with the very kinds of problems I'm trying to draw to your attention." Or, "We should expect to feel some discomfort with Gestalt theory's observations and proposals. This is because our way of talking is itself epistemologically loaded. The reductionism that is part of the texture of acceptable academic speech won't allow us to express what is fundamental to the Gestalt view in compelling terms. This is why it is crucial to keep reminding ourselves of our actual experience of meaning, those times when our breath has been taken away, when our vision has been altered. When we focus on this experience, we know immediately that it's important. It's one of the grand reasons for getting up in the morning. And so if we keep its image before us, we'll want to tell the truth about it. We'll be willing to find, we'll be willing to struggle to find a way to do so. Because there's overwhelming evidence that we do often think and perceive in ways that standard aggregative theories cannot account for, I think it's reductionist prejudice that has to go, not Gestalt's. This is not to say that aggregative synthesis is not a kind of thinking. It's to say that it is not the only kind there is, and that it is not always the most important kind. In the following figures, the two types of insight are reduced to their respective cores. In the first, on the left, the figure appears initially to have no meaning, and then suddenly, when we see it as a word connected to its own mirror image, it does. Well, if you are having, see it? Yeah. The effect is the mental equivalent of dropping a crystal of sodium acetate into a supersaturated solution. In the second figure, we perceive spontaneously a transparent box projecting either up and to the right or down and to the left. The first time we're exposed to the figure, it's usually stable in one orientation, and we have to be invited to perceive it in the other. But once we've experienced the shift, we can re-perform it at will. We frequently use the vocabulary of recognition to describe our experiences of insight, and this is no accident. The experience is indeed one of recognizing a situation. The word recognition, however, implies, as does the word insight, that we've grasped something true, and not all Gestalts are veridical. Wertheimer's first laboratory experiment was in fact designed to demonstrate the intransigence of a demonstrably false Gestalt, the so-called phi phenomenon. If a subject is positioned at a certain distance from two separate lights that flash on and off in a certain rhythm, she will perceive not two distinct flashes, but a single light moving continuously between the two positions. Kepler's vision of the relations of the planetary orbits to the five perfect solids proved illusory, although it struck him with such tremendous force that it continued to inspire his thinking even after he himself had demonstrated that it was false. What this reveals is that the experience of meaning is not always an experience of truth. What it does not show is that Gestalts are generally unreliable, much less that they are merely subjective impressions. The phi phenomenon is as objective as perceptions get. Everyone sees one moving light instead of two. But surely, someone will protest, Gestalts aren't as real as elementary sensations. The downward projecting box and the upward projecting box are just interpretations of an array that is in fact neither. But this is again a restatement of reductionist prejudice. It misses the point that our immediate experience of the Necker cube is of one box or the other. An array of lines that is neither is in fact an abstraction from immediate experience. I don't want to deny that elementary sensations exist. I want only to note that there is no perceptual evidence that they are the building blocks of our experience of the world. They don't exist the way perceptions do. Quote, "I stand at the window and see a house, trees, sky," writes Wertheimer. "Theoretically, I might say there are 327 brightnesses and nuances of color. Do I have 327? No, I have sky, house, and trees. Are skies, houses, and trees, melodies, and faces real? They are what we perceive. If this is what it is to experience meaning, to have a gestalt crystallize out of chaos, or to sense the internal relations between one gestalt and another, why or how does an absence of clutter matter to this process? That it matters, at least in some cases, is clear. Ben Shahn, the painter and printer, said that one of the most important stages in the emergence of a work of art is, quote, "the abolishing of excessive content, the abolishing of whatever material is extraneous to inner harmony, to the order of shapes that has been established." It's important to remember that this is no minimalist manifesto. Shahn intended his remark to have wide application, and his own work is warm and richly textured. Among lyric poets, too, lyric writers in general, less is more is one of the few near universal precepts. Bartlett cites Robert Browning as its source in English, but the thought is as old as Hesiod. Why should this be so? How could less be more? Towards the end of War and Peace, Tolstoy's protagonist, Pierre Bezukhov, is captured by the French, imprisoned in a rudimentary camp for a month, and then forced to march west with the French as they retreat. It's October. He has no shoes. On the first evening of the march, Pierre moves off by himself and settles on the frozen ground by a cartwheel to think. He's motionless for over an hour and then suddenly bursts into a huge, happy laugh. It's so loud that people around the campfires turn in astonishment and someone comes to investigate. Pierre moves farther away, staring out across the complex and beautiful landscape now revealed by the moon. Quote, "And all this is mine, and all this is in me, and all this is me," thought Pierre. "And all this they've caught and put in a shed and boarded it up." He smiled and went to his comrades to lie down and sleep. This is the moment of Pierre's inner transformation, the effects of which will play out over the remainder of his life. Tolstoy describes the transformation abstractly in this way, quote, "In captivity, in the shed, Pierre had learned, not with his mind, but with his whole being, his life, that man is created for happiness, and that all unhappiness comes not from lack, but from superfluity." Months later, rescued, recovered from a serious illness, Pierre appears, Tolstoy tells us, almost unchanged in his external ways. He looks the same, he's still absent-minded, kind, and distracted. His servants, however, notice that he has become, quote, "much simpler," and he ceased being a talker and become an exceptional listener. Before his experience in the war, he had appeared unhappy, whereas now he seemed always to be smiling. Quote, "Formerly, he'd been unable to see the great, the unfathomable, and infinite in anything. He'd only sensed that it must be somewhere and had sought for it. He'd armed himself with a mental spyglass and gazed into the distance. Now he had learned to see it in everything and joyfully contemplated the ever-changing, ever-great, unfathomable, and infinite life around him." There's a great deal going on here. War and Peace is a big novel. But one way of summarizing Tolstoy's claim is this: paring life to its basics allows one to see its ontological core, which is that the world is a resonant whole. The American poet Robert Haas, discussing the minimalist imagism of haiku, says something eerily reminiscent of Pierre's changed experience of seeing. Quote, "Often enough, when a thing is seen clearly, there is a sense of absence about it, as if the more palpable it is, the more some immense subterranean displacement seems to be working in it, as if at the point of truest observation, the visible and invisible exerted enormous counterpressure." To put this in Gestalt terms, the whole is experienced through the particular, which is a part of it. This is possible only if every part is internally related to every other part, if it is the nature of the whole that determines both what and that any part is. Visualize a geodesic sphere. Because its nodes are dimensionless points, each exists only as a set of angles. Now, imagine the sphere's lines still rigid but somehow threaded with elastic, like those tent poles, you know, for the lightweight tents that you can carry, so that any or all of the nodes can move. If any one of them does move, this will affect the angles that determine it. Some will contract, some will expand, as will the constituting angles of every other node, because it is in fact connected to every other one. Now put the whole thing in motion. Each node will be in interdefined dynamic relation with every other node, and each will necessarily reflect the state of the whole at every moment. It is in some such way, Tolstoy is claiming, that Pierre came to experience the world through its individual beings. Here, an observation from Arne Naess, the environmental philosopher and scholar of Spinoza, is crucial. Naess points out that ecosystems theory draws a distinction between complexity and complicatedness. What is complicated is disunified, chaotic. Naess gives the example of trying to find your way through a huge, unfamiliar city without a map. What is complex, by contrast, may be intricate, but it's not chaotic. It has a unifying gestalt. Naess's example, of course, is an ecosystem. By definition, a complex thing cannot be simple in the sense of having no parts or divisions. It will have multiple aspects, and there are often many different relations among these aspects. But complexity is uncluttered. Everything fits. Clutter, then, may be defined as that which does not belong to a gestalt, that which has no internal relation to other aspects of an array. Another way to describe Pierre's transformation, then, is to say that he ceased to experience the world as complicated and came to experience it as complex. The geodesic sphere, talk of arrays, these are visual images. Ben Shahn, you'll recall, although he's a visual artist, speaks of abolishing whatever material is extraneous to inner harmony. His image is aural. It suggests that in powerful gestalts, we experience the presence of internal relations as the mutual attunement of parts or aspects. Because of this attunement, the gestalt as a whole is resonant. When one part sounds, other parts sound as well. Clutter is anything that damps down or muffles this resonance. Mies van der Rohe, who was himself fond of the phrase less is more, also often said, God is in the details. What he was pointing to, I believe, is the way the meaning of a well-wrought whole arises from the resonant attunement of its parts. I said at the outset that what we prize in mathematical demonstrations is what we prize in works of art, the ability to precipitate an experience of meaning. Marjorie Wickler Seneschal puts it this way, quote, "Paul Erdős, the great 20th century mathematician who loved only numbers, an atheist, claimed that God has a book in which the best proof of every theorem is written. Erdős never listed the criteria a proof must satisfy to be inscribed in God's book. He didn't need to. Though no one has seen the book or ever will, all mathematicians know that Euclid's proof of the infinitude of primes is in it, and no mathematician doubts that computer-generated proofs, the kind that methodically check case after case, are not. The proofs in God's book are elegant. They surprise. In other words, They are light, quick, exact, and visible. In other words, the proofs in God's book involve gestalt shifts. They are potent with meaning. They may be complex, but they are not complicated. There is no clutter. They do not tediously spell everything out. They invite us to see what they are saying. Arthur Koestler describes his own experience with Euclid's proof of the infinitude of primes this way. Since I had become acquainted with Euclid's proof at school, it had always filled me with a deep satisfaction that was aesthetic rather than intellectual. Now, as I recalled the method and scratched the symbols on the wall, Koestler was in prison in Spain, anticipating execution at any moment, I felt the same enchantment. And then, for the first time, I suddenly understood the reason for this enchantment. The scribbled symbols on the wall represented one of the rare cases where a meaningful and comprehensive statement about the infinite is arrived at by precise and finite means. The significance of this swept over me like a wave, leaving in its wake only a wordless essence. I must have stood there for some minutes, entranced, until I noticed some slight mental discomfort nagging at the back of my mind, some trivial circumstance that marred the perfection of the moment. Then I remembered the nature of that irrelevant annoyance. I was, of course, in prison and might be shot. But this was immediately answered by a feeling whose verbal translation would be, "So what? Is that all? Have you got nothing more serious to worry about?" An answer so spontaneous, fresh, and amused, as if the intruding annoyance had been the loss of a collar stud. I've quoted at length because the echoes of Pierre's experience are so striking. Mathematical demonstrations like Euclid's proof involve the crystallization of certain internal relationships. We see that the theorem has to be so. They are like haiku, single images through which the resonance of something larger sounds. Other demonstrations, like the one attributed to Gauss, that there is a simple way to obtain the sum of any continuous sequence of integers, involve gestalt shifts. We see things first one way, and we see them, the same things, another way. This is the essence not of haiku, but of metaphor. X is not Y, and yet it is. It is the dawning of the second gestalt in relation to the first, that is the experience of meaning. In either case, whether the gestalt crystallizes or shifts, if there are pieces left over, details that don't fit, we may, as Ptolemy and subsequently Copernicus did, ignore them. Tuck them away into eccentrics and epicycles. We don't see them as details that don't fit. Sometimes, though, they start to bother us, and once that happens, we have become aware of them as clutter. We want to clear them up. What was once a gestalt, something we saw, becomes merely a model, an interpretation of the data. That model may still have the weight and cultural, the weight of cultural authority behind it, but it doesn't ring with its own authority. We keep revisiting the clutter, as Kepler did Tycho's observations of Mars, until the penny drops. We don't like messy or complicated models in science or messy and complicated images in poems because even when they save the phenomena, they don't precipitate an experience of meaning. So we come to understand that a gestalt is false, that an alleged proof is in error, because we acknowledge the existence of perceptions or data that don't fit. We experience irresoluble clutter that blocks a satisfying experience of meaning. But now, what is the ontological status of that clutter? How, on the gestalt account, if parts are not spontaneously perceived but are perceived subsequent to wholes, how do we become aware of recalcitrant data in the first place? Come to that, how is it that we can perceive aspects, details, parts, whatever we want to call them, at all? We may be spontaneously aware of faces as wholes, but we can certainly attend to their eyes and noses and experience them spontaneously as eyes and noses, too. Indeed, it appears that we perceive those eyes and noses as integrated wholes themselves. We recognize them without being able to draw or accurately specify their elemental building blocks either. When we focus on them, ignoring their context, we perceive them as though they were gestalts. That's because they are gestalts. noses, eyes, motifs in melodies, individual triangles in a visual proof, anything we see or understand as a thing, that very mysterious word in English, has shape, is a whole whose own aspects are internally related. And it works the other way as well. A face can become an aspect of a photograph, or of a painting, or a crowd. A melody can become an aspect of the first subject of a movement in a sonata, which in turn can become an aspect of the movement as a whole. The world, in other words, is an immense complex of subordinate and superordinate gestalts. To paraphrase the homespun philosopher, it's gestalts all the way down and up, too. It's also gestalts sideways. What is the ontological status of clutter? Clutter consists of what we might call con or periordinate gestalts, things that don't fit. Facts we say we don't understand but wish we did, recalcitrant data. It consists of gestalts that don't seem to belong to a superordinate gestalt. Or, to put it another way, of gestalts that don't seem to have internal relations to other subordinate gestalts. Their perception, therefore, does not precipitate an experience of meaning. This failure to precipitate an experience of meaning is the hallmark of conordinate gestalts. I believe this is what Richard Feynman had in mind when he claimed that nobody understands quantum mechanics. Why not? Because, according to Feynman, nothing in our experience is analogous to the behavior of electrons and photons. At the core of the gestalt theory of learning is the view that to understand something just is to perceive its relevant structural similarity to some other thing or situation. The perception of telling similarity is the litmus that understanding has occurred. Where such perception is absent, we may have the facts, but we have no superordinate gestalt. We don't see why they are the facts. We don't know what they mean. So we keep looking at them this way, that way, hoping to sense connections. The fact of false gestalts, the tangled history of European views of planetary motion, for example, raises another issue about the relation between meaning and simplicity. A desire for truth, for accuracy, is part of the picture, but it's not the only part. Tycho, who made the observations on which Kepler's view is founded, was himself a geocentrist. And Kepler made a number of mistakes in the calculations he based on Tycho's data. But he refused to believe that the cosmological picture could be geometrically complicated. So he kept returning to Tycho's observations, and at last, after years of effort, they precipitated a beautiful, uncluttered ellipse for the orbit of Mars. Indeed, it may be Copernicus's commitment to cosmological simplicity that made him reluctant to publish his own increasingly epicycle-ridden view. We ourselves look at Kepler's three laws and marvel at their simplicity. Ah, we say, sweeping the epicycles off the table. Of course. What, though, is the foundation of that "of course"? Why keep plugging away at Tycho's observations? Why keep trying to understand quantum mechanics? Aristotle said it's simply what humans do, that by nature we want to grasp the similarities that unify our experience and make it whole. I was stunned when I went back to Metaphysics Alpha and found that that's what's in the opening paragraph. The opening sentence says, "All men by nature desire to know," but then you read on, and it's this incredible prefiguration of gestalt theory. I think Aristotle was right. It's a raw fact about our intelligence. We prefer less complicated gestalts to more complicated ones. The gestalt theorists characterized our preference in terms of the so-called law of prégnance, a word that might be translated as concision, and which, in gestalt theory, connotes pattern, regularity, and orderliness. They further specified aspects of the law of prégnance, features possessed by subordinate gestalts that will make them tend to hang together. Similarity, closure, proximity, unified movement, and the like. Critics have urged that the notions of prégnance and its various subspecies are too vague to be useful. Tendencies, they point out, aren't laws. But the thing is, it isn't just any arrangement that does genuinely hang together. Or better, even in a case of extraordinary ontological insight like Pierre Bezukhov's, things don't hang together in any old way. It isn't, as Poincaré notes, any odd or bizarre combination of facts or objects that will be mathematically fertile. It isn't any juxtaposition of images in a poem or painting, nor any harmonic sequence in a string quartet that will strike us as profound. To deny this, to claim that anything can be as meaningfully connected to one thing as to another, is to fail to be responsible to our experience. I do not think we have explanations of the tendencies the Gestalt theorists identified. This doesn't mean we shouldn't think those tendencies don't exist. Great physicists and philosophers have argued that the big cosmological picture has to be simple. They have good reason. F equals ma, E equals mc squared, the force of gravity equals the gravitational constant times the product of the masses divided by the square of their distance. These gestalts, the gestalts these equations express, are about as simple as it gets, and they comprehend an immense array of perceptual data. They have put human beings on the moon and got them back. And yet, the diagonal of a unit square is incommensurable with its sides. The decimal expansion of pi has no calculable resolution. At the very heart of European cosmological pictures for the last 2,400 years is a less than perfect fit between rational numbers and geometry. We can form no good gestalt of their relationship. Why is this? We don't know. Maybe that's the way the world is. Or maybe the problem is this. Gestalt thinking and perception constitute one kind of intelligence, and calculation constitutes another. And neither comprehends the other, neither can fully translate the other into its own terms. I know of no concerted efforts to document this claim, but there are a number of studies that document a related claim, that gestalt comprehension and language use are somehow at odds. Wertheimer suspected this was the case, and in an essay entitled Einstein, The Thinking That Led to the Theory of Relativity, he includes a long footnote in which Einstein reports that it was a long time before he formulated his insight axiomatically. Quote, "These thoughts did not come in any verbal formulation," he said. "I very rarely think in words at all." Wertheimer pushed him, responding that many people claim that they always think in words. Einstein, reports Wertheimer, merely laughed. More recently, over the past two decades, an American experimental psychologist, Jonathan Schuller, has made laboratory experiments that repeatedly confirm a phenomenon that he has dubbed verbal overshadowing. Schuller and his associates have shown that the ability to recognize previously seen faces or previously heard segments of music, to perform gestalt shifts of the Necker-Cube variety, to perceive analogies, whether these are presented visually or in words, narrative analogies, and to solve a wide range of insight problems. All of these things are impaired by attempts to describe the figure, the face, or the thought processes involved. It's been an uphill battle. This is not a fact cognitive psychology wants to recognize. In one of his earlier papers, Schuller describes yet other studies that clearly demonstrate the negative effects of requiring subjects to verbalize their perception, and notes that these studies wave away their own results. They regard them as anomalous, or conclude that their experimental subjects were not properly trained. As Schuller says, quote, "Verbal processing has been assumed to be the deepest and most memorable form of processing. The present zeitgeist emphasizing the value of verbal processing has caused researchers to generally overlook or simply disregard its potential to produce interference." End quote. This zeitgeist has also caused most Western intellectuals to ignore or reject the importance of gestalt comprehension, and thereby to avoid serious contemplation of the experience of meaning. The prospectus for this conference asked three questions. Why is the idea of simplicity so important in scientific practice? Is simplicity or any other aesthetic value truth conducive? How do the principles of simplicity and economy of means function in various artistic practices. Simplicity, I have argued, is not actually what we're after. We're after insight, a shift from a complicated situation, one that consists of a bunch of conordinate gestalts or sometimes even a mass of inchoate impressions, to a complex one, one in which parts and whole are interdefined. This might be called a quest for simplicity, but it's not simplicity in a quantitative sense. It has nothing to do with numbers or components or limits on the types or amounts of interdefinition. It has to do with the absence of things that don't fit. There are, notoriously, no criteria in the arts or sciences for achieving or executing such integrated wholes. But in the absence of such criteria, need not mean that the wholes themselves are suspect. It could mean, and I think it does, that the demand for criteria is sometimes misplaced. In addition to the worry that there are no reductionist definitions of its key terms, one of the major objections to Gestalt theory has been that there are no exceptionalist laws that apply to all cases, no formulae that will accurately predict what Gestalt will emerge in any given situation. But Gestalt thinking does not occur verbally, even if the Gestalt itself is a word complex like a poem. Computers cannot describe insight accurately because computational structures of their essence consist of discrete, non-interdefined elements arranged in rule-governed sequences. This is exactly what a Gestalt is not. Perhaps, as we come to understand more about how brains work, we'll be able to formulate reductionist biophysical laws that underlie Gestalt thinking and perception. Or perhaps we will come to appreciate that we are looking for a kind of representation of a Gestalt thinking that we cannot have, that Gestalt thinking will always underlie any satisfactory biophysical laws we formulate. And the deep mystery will remain. The deep answer starts to look like Plato's. Being consists of gestalts. What is shape, except it's shape in motion. There's nothing changeless or eternal about it. Heraclitus, then, the riddler, who saw change and unity and dynamic interdefinition as the fundamental features of the cosmos, and was quite content to allow the strain on language in the form of repeated and multiple paradoxes to stand unresolved, who asserted that this bending and breaking of linguistic intelligence was the price of understanding. In North American philosophy, computational models of learning have linked hands with logico-linguistic analysis and penetrated deeply into the idea of what epistemology is. Analogical thinking is dismissed as weak or inferior. The idea that there might be philosophically significant thought that occurs without words is still a kind of heresy. The idea that meaning itself might be a nonverbal phenomenon is not even on the radar. But I am convinced it is the truth. The famous anecdotes from the history of science, mathematics, and the arts, the repeated lab experiments with hundreds of unremarkable undergraduates confirm it. Insight is not verbal. If you try to make it verbal, you shut it down. By demanding that people think verbally, we are depriving them of the experience of meaning. They will know increasingly what is the case, but less and less will they have a sense that they understand why. Yet a sense that we understand why is one of the things human beings most deeply desire. It's what we want from mathematics, science and the arts. I think it's even what we want from philosophy, the revelation of meaning. We want to experience gestalt so powerful they make us change our lives. I do not know why we want this. One possibility is that that's what being is, the resonance of gestalts. When we experience meaning, we are, to a greater or lesser degree, filled with resonance ourselves. If being is resonance, then in such moments, we more completely are. That is, anyway, how it seems. That's how the experience of meaning gestalts itself. Thank you so much.